Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, president of the American Academy. It's my pleasure to welcome you and call to order the 2065th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Well, as you enter the Academy this evening, you may have walked past the Gilbert Stuart portrait of John Adams that is hanging in the lobby. Adams, along with James Bowdoin and other scholar patriots, founded our Academy in the midst of the Revolutionary War. And even with the great upheaval around them, they recognized the need, and I quote, to cultivate every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. Indeed, they saw people as the greatest asset to a democratic republic. As we know, Adams would go on to be the Academy's second president, as well as the second president of the U.S., posts he held at the same time for a while. You may also have walked by Thomas Jefferson's letter in response to his election to the Academy in 1787. Took him a while, but in 1791, he wrote back and praised the work of the Academy while simultaneously keeping a distance, saying, and I quote, this is from his letter, "However, wedded by affection to the objects of the Academy's pursuit, I'm obliged to unremitting attentions to other less acceptable to my mind and much less attracting. I read with pleasure whatever comes from the Society and am happy in the occasion given me of assuring them of my respect and attachment." So he said in his letter. But after that, less attracting pursuits went out, and our archives hold no further communication from Jefferson. That was it. His correspondence with John Adams would also suffer many years of silence. Their friendship, as we most know, fell victim to the election of 1800, an election that itself has often been referred to as a revolution, in which two patriots, Adams, the sitting president, and Jefferson, the vice president, engaged in a political contest that's often described as the birth of active political campaigning. The election was bitterly fought. Adams' Federalist comrades attacked Jefferson, and I quote, as an atheist in religion and a fanatic in politics, while Jefferson's Republicans assailed Adams as a would-be monarchist, whose use of federal power to crush dissent was a return to all the revolution had been fought to change. The complexities of the election were too numerous to recount here, but the electoral deadlock that confronted the nation was unprecedented and aroused tensions and concerns to a fever pitch all around the new nation. Eventually, as we've learned from the Broadway musical, Alexander Hamilton swung Federalist support behind Jefferson instead of Aaron Burr, electing Jefferson president and effectively ending Adams' political career. They would eventually resume correspondence in 1812 at the urging of Academy fellow Benjamin Rush. And the two former presidents wrote to one another regularly until their deaths, separated by only hours on the 50th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence, July 4th, 1826. Adams would, as he predicted, go on to occupy a place in the second tier of our national memory. While Jefferson survived as an inescapably intriguing character of the founding era, the cultured, contradictory genius who remains a controversial figure in American history. Politicians across the ideological spectrum invoke his name, and scholars debate his legacy. And I expect, even in this room, there is significant variation in how you think and feel about our nation's third president. Jefferson, perhaps more than our other founders, holds a mystery for us. He was a true Republican who feared a powerful executive, yet he exerted the authority of the office beyond its legal scope. He was a homebody, but he served as the new nation first Secretary of State. But the most notable and most disappointing contradiction in Jefferson's character that has been the focus of our program tonight, a slave owner who penned the defining document of our nation's belief in the equity of men. Jefferson's ideals on race and democracy are not easily reconciled. As we continue to watch our country grapple with the legacy of our original national sin, slavery, and its immense and persistent impact on the functioning of our society, it's helpful to return to our roots and discuss the ideas and influence of one of our most enduring founders. Our speakers tonight are leading scholars of Jefferson. Their 2016 book, Most Blessed of Patriarchs, Thomas Jefferson and the Empire of Imagination. And that will form the basis of their discussion this evening, and we do want this to be a discussion. There'll be a chance for questions and back and forth. Their full bios are in your program, but let me just say a couple words about each. Annette Gordon Reed is a Charles Warren Professor of American Legal History at Harvard Law School and a Professor of History in the Arts, Faculty of Arts and Sciences. Her books include the Pulitzer Prize-winning The Hemings of Monticello, An American Family, and Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, An American Controversy. Peter Onuf is the Thomas Jefferson Memorial Foundation Professor Emeritus at the University of Virginia and is currently the Mellon Distinguished Scholar at the American Antiquarian Society. His works include The Mind of Thomas Jefferson and Jefferson's Empire, The Language of American Nationhood. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Annette Gordon Reed and Peter Onuf.